Okay, thank you very much, Bill, for the introduction. I want to talk about the use of Blue Waters, this big machine, for tabletop science. Tabletop science that involves actually many thousands of researchers over the world, and literally 100,000 of people who use the software that we describe. So we don't have few telescopes, and we also don't aim to the very small or very large, but rather we aim at topics that are connected right with our existence on Earth, namely with all those issues that come about through medicine and today also technology and biology, namely the life science research. So here is our work that led to the use of Blue Waters over the last decade and a half. And it started in 1990 with describing small molecules of about 10,000 atoms that was considered large at the time. But the living cell is the smallest real living thing. A protein is not living. And in case of a human cell, the living cell has as many proteins as the United States has citizens. And so if you want to understand the United States, you need to understand society. So you need to understand the individual, but also the family, the neighborhood, the village, the city, the metropolitan area, the state, and then the country. And so there is basically a huge demand for computing. If you are dealing first with individual, the protein, and if you want to go to truly living systems. And so truly living system, we didn't quite reach yet, but on this scale, that's pretty much also the scale of the history of NCSA and with their various computers, we went on, and we can today describe a significant part of a living cell called an organelle, which is sort of like an inside piece of a cell that carries out an autonomous function on its own. It cannot live without the cell, but it's already an important part. And we reach that, that's possible through Blue Waters, and that is why Blue Waters is a real revolution for us. But it's interesting to realize that the programs that we use are the same that all these hundreds of thousands of medical researchers and biologists and botanists use on their laptops. And so we have the same user interface, so whatever we do on Blue Waters very effectively trickles down to also improve the software for the many. So here you see in between sizes protein and other cellular systems. Now this development to go and reach much, much further than where we were in 1990 was only possible through a very close collaboration with Sanjay Kale, my colleague here at the University of Illinois. And so I want to say right away that that this work is actually on one side, work on the computer science side, and on the other side, the work by researchers. We are both driven by the desire to bring the absolute top technology that is used, as we've seen in the great example of physics, by physicists usually at the, in astronomy and in elementary particle physics. We want to bring the same to the life sciences and want to, does not imply here just a future sense, but it implies already a lot of achievement. So I think that there is nothing where we do not compare in the life sciences, even though we are tabletop science and we work with hundreds of thousands of people, where we do not compare with what the physicists are offering on their big projects. So here we see again the systems that we can study today. And I jump right away to the largest system that you see, namely the photosynthetic chromatophore. That is actually a piece of a whole cell, of a photosynthetic cell. And that was actually the acceptance test, one of the acceptance tests of blue waters. To simulate it requires 100 million atoms. And we achieved that in October 2012. And it was a totally a great test. So let me describe it to you. Here's a habitat, but this bacterium doesn't live in the beautiful sky where the plants are, but rather at the bottom of ponds, in the mud, in topsoil. But there are many of them. Here you see a bacterial cell, and you see these rings. This is actually, they are really belonging to spheres, these chromatophores, but this is a 200 angstrom slice drilled with iron beams. And now we focus on this chromatophore that you have just seen a minute before. And this is one of these organelles. A cell has about 100 of them that absorb sunlight and turn its energy into fuel that drives cellular processes. The system is made of 6 different proteins, color-coded here. And for all together, we have about 130 proteins. And the proteins contain many thousands of chromophores that actually absorb the sunlight and store the sun energy and then guide it on where the energy is then utilized for synthesizing the chemical fuel. And so this is the system that we chose as an acceptance test. And here you see actually the system up close, so you see there our 100 million atom simulation of the chromatophore on the top right, and on the left you see a little bit of a detail. You see there, they looks almost like flowers, the yellow spots there, those are lipids, and those are actually groups of atoms, so if you would come real close, you would see that we have really incredible detail in this description. So every atom is represented. Now on the bottom right, you see how we scale in doing, in treating these systems. We have here the scaling on blue waters for different size systems, the smallest 15 million atom and the largest, the chromatophore, 100 million atoms. And we have full circles and triangles, those are with the use of GPU, which we can use very effectively, and the open ones are without. And you see that we scale very well, but we are coming also at a point where we break around and we have a revolutionary new a method of calculating Coulomb interactions that might actually allow us in the future to scale even further. And so this is basically showing how we utilize every day the Blue Waters computer. Now, in our hands, Blue Waters is actually not a playground for computational biologists, but it is actually a scientific instrument. The publications that we have with Blue Waters have many experimentalists and leading experimental labs as co-authors, because Blue Waters is actually interpreting experimental data, and only Blue Waters can interpret the experimental data. Here is a key example. We have on one side the big accelerators where we can, through X-ray scattering, study the structure of crystals, of biomolecules, but in a crystalline form, the biomolecules are not free to move. On the other side, we have the world-leading electron microscopes that can see actually proteins in action, but not at sufficient resolution to see the chemical and atomic and physical detail. But when you combine the crystallographic information and the electron microscopy information, then you can actually lead it computationally to a unique interpretation. and thought to interpret data from different modalities can only be done in the computer. And this is a very important field over just the last 5 years, with many publications in Science, Nature, Cells. These are our leading life science journals. And so let me give you a few examples. So the first one is actually a very critical example for what is called the antibiotic resistance crisis. You know that there is a huge threat, a medical threat, that the overuse of antibiotics leads to resistance, so that we might soon die from very simple diseases where today antibiotics work, but tomorrow they will not anymore. So we need to understand how these antibiotics that were actually discovered by happenstance, how they actually work. And an important target is a complex, large biomolecule called the ribosome. And so with the ribosome could be interpreted exactly with this computational strategy in atomic detail with antibiotics bound. Here, for example, with a very common prescription antibiotic. And so here, for the first time, we could see in atomic detail and even electronic detail how the antibiotic actually interferes with the function of bacterial ribosomes. And this is work together with biomedical researchers. And that leads to completely new strategies for antibiotics. And the ribosome is a main target, actually, for antibiotics. Here we have an result from AIDS virus, also important medical thing. Here we see a structure that is being fitted into the density of the AIDS virus material that was measured by electron microscopy. The structure came from crystallography, and we could combine it together and could then describe simple structures of the viral material, but we could also then predict the entire virus capsid. And here you see this magnificent structure of this capsid. It is made of over 1,300 proteins. It is sort of rather heterogeneous on its surface, following a famous law of Euler. It is made of hexamers in blue and 12 pentamers. And so we have very different local symmetries and a lot of heterogeneity. Nevertheless, the capsid is made of a single protein. And this huge system containing 4 million atoms on the side of the capsid and 64 million on the side of the whole simulation that was published last year in Nature. It was one of the early Blue Water Period project that led immediately to great success. Here you see all the atomic detail that is in this model. If I would show you only atoms, you would not see anything. And so this was really a great step forward, because what we have in our hands now is an atomic level picture of the capsid. And when you go to the doctor, most of the time what they do is they prescribe you some drugs, and the drugs act in your body on the chemical level. And so new HIV treatments likewise work with drugs, and here we have the target for the drugs. And we see here how this capsid is actually a very dynamical entity that can develop when you apply electrical field holds, so that it can prevent osmotic shocks. The center hole there can transport chloride channel ions, and the side holes can transport sodium channels, so that this is a very stable coat. And this is a coat on which now drugs work. And we have one fantastic drug, namely PF74. It's really acting on this virus and really makes it totally ineffective, except it also kills a patient. And so we know how it works, but we cannot be quite happy with it, so we need to modify it. And so here you see in this sort of spherical van der Waals pictures the PF74, and we know exactly where it bound. And before the structure was available, we knew exactly what it was doing. It binds and cracks it open. Now we know this is completely wrong. It doesn't crack it open, it keeps it unstable. How does it work then? And only through the blue water structure could we find out. We found out that this is a very mean-spirited disease. This virus, when it enters a cell, persuades the cell to help it to go to the cell nucleus to insert its genetic material. As a result, it interacts with proteins of the cell that helps it by also binding to the surface, and PF74 prevents that. And so we have a completely new picture of how to now develop a new strategy for treatment that only became available through the structure solution of this important scientific instrument, blue waters. Here we have another very important virus, for human important. This one is maybe first a little funny almost. It's a rabbit virus. The virus that is the basis of or the cause for an epidemic in rabbits in China. And so the leading Chinese scientist, the Chinese Academy of Science, worked with us to solve on blue waters the structure of this virus. This was actually the first structure we solved on blue waters. Now, who cares about rabbits? Now, in China, they do because they have the big rabbit industry. They eat a lot of it. But this rabbit virus is related to something you see there on the bottom, to the porcine epidemic diarrhea virus, which is a huge threat to the porcine industry in the United States. And so this research gives us now a direction of how to solve an equally or maybe even bigger problem in the United States by solving a structure, using it as a target, and developing either a vaccine or developing a drug treatment. So here come now some projects that are sort of the future project we are involved with, but some that we are already working on intensely right now. And this is a microtubule. It is this green stuff on the right side. On the right side, you see two views of a living cell that has a cytoskeleton inside. In blue is the nucleus. And so this cytoskeleton gives the cell the stability, and it also organizes cell divisions and all kinds of cellular processes. And the structure of this microtubulin was solved in blue water through a combination again of crystallography and absolutely top electron microscopy from one of the best instruments in the world at Berkeley. And so why do we care? We care because it is interesting biologically, but it is also a target for very important anti-cancer drugs. And why do we need blue waters? Again, we have a huge system to deal with that we need to know at the atomic level. It's huge, but the atomic properties are key for the overall function in the cell. And so this is the problem, and this is the reason why we need blue waters. So we have these huge molecular structures, and every normal person would say, oh, don't care about the detail, that cannot be important. No, that is a problem. The detail is important because the properties carry all the way through to the macroscopic properties that are important for the living cell. And so here we have now simulated in blue waters already the pure microtubule, then a microtubule that with end caps, because these things are constantly growing and diminishing and growing in a living cell with a huge quick dynamic. And then we have also a microtubulin with a kinesin that are motor proteins that crawl along these fibers in the cell to transport material through the cell. And so this gives us a huge potential now for studying very basic biological problems, but also to study, medically speaking, very practical problems. For example, how one of the most common used cancer drugs, Taxol, used in chemotherapy, works on on the microtubule of cancer cells. And what we want to understand is, how it does it. We want to make it more specific to reduce side effects in chemotherapy. And we want to find new treatments because some cancers became resistant against Taxol. And so here again, we have a completely new basis of cancer treatment that is promised in an, at the moment, ongoing project on Blue Waters. Now, my next example, and I'm coming slowly to the end, is what we like to call the bacterial brain. Bacteria swim in the environment, and they try to find an optimal location in the environment where the food sources are, and they want to go away from what they call repellent, from poisonous material or UV light. And they do that by swimming and changing the swimming direction. And this is done by a system that I like to refer to here, the bacterial brain that gets at the head of the bacterium sensory information from receptors at the outside. This is the end where the flagella are that make the bacterium swim. You see the flagella at one end always. And here in the middle, we have inside the bacterium the brain that integrates the signals from the receptors, from thousands of receptors, and puts them into some plane that you see here that changes its structure from an inactive form to an active form. In a way that is quite remarkable, because either it is in one form, then the cell says swim on, or it is in the other form, they said stop now and find a better direction. And so it is a decision plane that you find in this bacterial brain. And that is also likely a target for drug molecules once we have established the chemical structure. We are pretty far ahead there, and once we understand its function. And lastly, I like to speak about some other extremely practical problem. That is a project that's going on already on Blue Waters, and that is to contribute to second generation biofuel production. That production uses industrial agricultural waste to make ethanol and then fuel, but the problem is it has to become cost effective, and to be cost effective you have to use the right enzymes. And here we are following a strategy on Blue Waters that comes from how bacteria do it. Bacteria are extremely good in working on waste, and they actually employ for this purpose on the outside of the bacterial cell what I may call a cocktail, thank you, a cocktail of enzymes, not just one enzyme, but they don't want these enzymes to run away. So they put them on this finger-like extension on the surface that are called cellulosomes that contain like fingers with actually thousands of fingers connected in this network. And they're very modular, so that you can add for one enzyme, a new enzyme here, a new enzyme there. You can even add it here. The system is made of Legos. And now there is a lot of motion and mechanical motion, fluidity going on in these systems. And what the systems show remarkably is that they have that they are made of complexes between the proteins. So for example, between here and there, if I maybe go to this movie back and forth, I might show you. Here you see the movie, and here you see this is one piece that connects to the yellow piece. And those pieces here have a connection that is dramatically stable in a very interesting way. When you put them together, they just stick together. But once you pull, they become as strong as chemical bonds. And so we have a very, very stable structure, and that was actually a discovery made through Blue Waters, where we could describe this entire system again, multi-million atom system, and here this very interesting Lego docking system with very, very strong Lego bonds. So now to the end. we are using blue waters effectively. We have been preparing ourselves for the use of blue waters for the program since over 5 years, and working very, very hard, even though there was not even a building yet, and it was a very abstract idea, but we believed in it and we developed. We also were very fortunate in realizing that we have a data problem. If we are getting the data on blue waters, then we have a huge system, a data to analyze, not only to store them and get them somewhere to look at, but also we need to analyze the data. And so we developed what we called a petascale gateway. It's in the building that we call here the Beckman Institute. It's near NCSA. And so we have here this gateway. So we are getting the data from Blue Waters, and we have an excellent connection on campus, and then we can visualize this huge amount of data. Much of the analysis is actually done again on Blue Waters, and then we store it back. But this is a very expensive proposition, and this interconnection is very hard. And so this is what we can do, but not everybody else can do. So our center can do it, but everybody else should do it differently. And we should have a way that we can do all this analysis, the storing of data, the analysis of the data on blue waters, and just send the graphics content to the investigators. And so we really like to push very much that NCFA, I know they are very interested in doing that actually, that they really develop this remote graphics capability, because that is in our hands essential. We could circumvent it, but many people think that we use secret software. We have been accused of all kinds of things, what we do on Blue Waters, because people don't have this capability, and they think what we think we can do is actually undoable. But with other fashion, it is possible. So we have also already quite a few numbers of publications on Blue Waters. The reddish ones are ones on science projects, and the black ones are publications on methodology on Blue Waters. So we just would like to show here that we are really going. These are published published work on both ends. And I might jump then end with great work on the AIDS virus that was published last year in Nature. And it just was also published in one of the leading AIDS journals, where the structure that I showed you before is shown there. And that is a telling sign that what we do actually on Blue Waters is relevant in a completely different community outside of computational scientists. And the message is close to my heart. I really like to thank NSF that they invested into Blue Waters, and I would also like to really thank the teams at NCFA that have made Blue Waters a very effective machine. Thank you very much. Actually, I only publish in Nature or Science because of my junior colleagues who want to do that. I would not ever voluntarily send them anything. There are boutique journals that completely corrupt the system of science. So we have actually a wonderful journal in the life sciences that tries to have an alternative model to science and nature, and that is called eLife. And there that is absolutely my favorite journal.